This week, as while all the handouts are being passed out, this week was a week of a lot of apologies. We're going to be out of town. We're going on vacation. We didn't want to go, but we have to. And I said, don't worry about that. This is why we're filming everything. This is why it's on Facebook and Periscope. We knew summer is a time people travel and sports are finishing up. So many things are going on. So there is no guilt here. There's only a desire to learn and grow. So don't ever think you cannot. I have one. So, anyways. So let me begin by sharing with you my approach. And I did a little bit of that last time. I was trying to explain even more, but it was hard to do that with all the things going wrong. But tonight, hopefully, we're not going to have as much trouble. We spent a lot of time making sure everything was going right. My desire in teaching this series was to teach it in the way I wish somebody would have taught me when I was studying hermeneutics. Sometimes I was so frustrated. I did not know any more than I did when I took a class in biblical interpretation. And I walked away going, I already knew that. Help me to see the big picture. Help me to understand things that, I can't get on the internet. Something more. Something that will make sense of passages in the Bible. I just don't need just one or two examples. Give me something, some tool that would help put the puzzle together. So the way I'm approaching this series is in the way that I wish somebody would have taught me. Okay, so the approach is very different. I haven't found this kind of approach anywhere else. I'm compiling it from different sources, my notes and other scholars. So this is very unique. So hopefully it's going to help you. Tonight is a tough one. So if you fall asleep, that's... I don't know what to say to that. I'm reading a book on brain and preaching. And one thing I've learned is when the brain begins to feel like this is too much, it begins to shut down. That's why people fall asleep in church. I didn't know that. So I don't know what you can do. Just remind yourself this is important and stay awake. Last week, we understood the incarnational model of Scripture. What does that mean? It means the Bible is a divine book. The Bible is a human book coming together without any errors. It is just like Jesus Christ. Remember, Jesus is in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Bible is also the Word of God. So we're using the same analogy and saying just like Jesus was fully God, fully man, without sin, so also the Bible is fully divine, fully human, and yet it has no errors. Why is that so important? Because I think many times we kind of lean on the side of the Bible only being a divine book. God said it, I believe it, that settles it. That is true. But when it comes down to studying the Bible and really getting between the layers and seeing what's happening and the differences, for that you have to bring in the human element. God is one, but Moses and David and Isaiah and Jeremiah and Matthew, Mark, Luke and John and Peter and Paul, these are different people. Does that make sense? God is one, so we know he doesn't change. But different people writing through their personalities, through their experiences, through their education, makes the Bible come alive. And it helps you see things in ways you've never seen before. So you need both, divine, human, coming together, but without errors. This week, we need to understand that we are where we are in the history of biblical interpretation. Again, I'm going to tell you, this is not how a typical Bible study class begins. This is not how a class in hermeneutics is taught. We need to understand where we fit in the history of biblical interpretation. To give an illustration, Let's say that you want to go into farming. Never farmed in your life, you want to go into farming. You have no clue what to do. Where do you begin? The question you have to ask is, well, what will you use to till the ground? How will you irrigate the soil? Where will you find the seeds? I mean, those are basic questions, right? You got a piece of land, but you have to answer these questions. Where do you begin? Well, wouldn't that be foolish if you were to go find a metal rod and then experiment with it to see how you can plow the ground? You know, this piece of metal, it doesn't plow very well. Maybe I can bend it a little bit. Okay, I think this will do it. So you start plowing. Well, I don't know. It's too narrow. Maybe I can flatten it out a little bit. Maybe that may cover more ground. Maybe I can get two rods and I can drag it down the field. You're catching where I'm going with this? You're trying to reinvent the wheel. How about irrigating the land? How do you do that? Well, maybe I can collect rainwater and somehow I can funnel it through the fields. And where am I going to get the seeds from? Well, I guess I got to walk around through the grass and see, and maybe through some other fields and find some seed. And then I can collect enough seeds and come back and, you know, after I've tilled the ground and got my rainwater, I can kind of sow the seeds everywhere and see what happens. Folks, a lot of work has been done in farming for the past few thousand years. Would you agree with that? Right? You don't have to go to this period. That's where most of the Bible study series go to. Back to the ox and the plow. We're somewhere here. We're in 2016. So much information we have. Why are we starting as if it's the first year of creation? You may not be an expert farmer. You may not have a PhD. You may not have enough information like a scholar in seminary or a university. But could you not start somewhere a little bit behind and say, well, I don't have to take a metal rod and try to bend it. Maybe I can go to a farm equipment place and buy some plows. Maybe I can buy a tractor. Irrigation, there are other ways to irrigate the field rather than trying to collect water and throw it on the ground. Seed, I don't have to go to a field and collect as much seed as possible. I can go to an outdoor supply place and maybe buy a big sack of seeds and bring it in. Most people, when they come down to studying the Bible, they begin with so much basic when this is where you should be, somewhere near this place. Does this analogy help? Is it making sense somewhat, or are y'all lost? Okay. In other words, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. And also, when you study the history of biblical interpretation, what we're talking about is, how did people interpret the Bible so far? It also brings a level of humility when we realize that we are simply a blip on the radar screen of biblical interpretation. We're just a blip. It is false pride, so to speak, if you want to say that, when people think, man, I have just come up with an awesome way to look at Scripture. Nobody would have ever thought of that. This is amazing. Be careful. If nobody's thought of it, there's a reason for that. If for the past 4,000 years, or at least 2,000 years, nobody has said what you said, more than likely, you're off the path. You have gone off on a tangent. You got to come back here. Get on the path. Okay? It brings a sense of humility. Listen, we are standing on the shoulders of millions and millions of men and women who have been trying to understand the Bible. Millions of them throughout the ages. So what we need to do is understand, where do we fit in? So Let's go a step further tonight. What are the major issues that people have struggled with through the ages? And I've given you all in your notes, so you don't have to kind of frantically try to write everything down. It's in your notes. It's on the blog site. What are the major issues that people have struggled with? I'm taking this from Moses Silva's book, Has the Church Misread the Bible? He's a scholar, used to teach at Westmont College, Westminster Theological Seminary, I think Gordon Conwell as well. Several things. Number one, God's word is divine yet human. We covered that, right? We already covered that. Second thing people have struggled with is God's commands are absolute and yet they are relative. In the Old Testament, God said, you know, build me a temple. David, you can't do it because your hands are covered with blood, but through your son, I will build a temple. Absolute command, isn't it? Do we have to obey that today? Unless y'all want to build a temple. It is absolute, but it's also relative because the context has changed. It is not just for building a temple. Many things in the Bible, yes, God said it, do this, but now it's become relative. Another thing people have struggled with is God's word should be clear, and yet it is ambiguous. That's why we have a series on Bible study. On one hand, yes, thus says the Lord. On the other hand, man, I don't know. What exactly did Paul mean? What was he talking about? At times, it is ambiguous. God's word only requires the Spirit. Have you heard people say that? Man, if you have the Holy Spirit, that's all you need. Yes or no? You need both, right? You do need the Holy Spirit, yet we need scholarship. A lot of people will tell you this. Get a pen, a paper, your Bible, get by yourself, and study it. I'm here to tell you, no. He said, oh, how dare you say that? You don't want us to study the Bible on our own? No. I want you to do your devotions on your own. When it's time for your devotional time in the morning, by all means, sit down with your Bible, with your favorite devotional book, Oswald Chambers, or whoever you like to, Streams in the Desert, or whatever you like to read. You sit down. This is my devotional time. Pen, paper, listening to God through His Word. When it comes down to Bible study, get some tools. Because you can be wrong. I don't begin just by sitting down with the Bible, pad and pen, ready to write. No, I begin with the commentaries. Now, this is not what you will hear, so unless you don't want to hear that, I don't know what to say. You get the best of the best commentary. By the way, throughout this series, I'm going to be giving you a list of commentaries, the best on each book, that will be beneficial. So if you're saying, I want to study the book of Ruth, I'll suggest a commentary that will be both simple and yet deep. They're out there. I begin by reading the commentary. Once I get the gist of the passage, I understand the issues involved. Now I'm ready to study it in detail. Sitting down with a pen and paper and writing down things that come to my mind. Like a doctor who comes to do surgery, what's the first thing he does? All right, where's the patient? Right there. All right, let's get going. What does he do? He's like, let me see the chart. All right, so this is what's going on. This is what's going on. Oh, it's the left leg, not the right. You know, does happen, folks, right? All right, so this is what needs to happen. All right, so pre-check. Okay, everything is good. Now we're ready to go. God's word is literal and historical, yet it's also figurative and non-historical. So how do we know when it is exactly what it says, other times it is not? These are things that people have struggled with through the ages. Another one, God's word only requires the interpreter's personal freedom and yet a certain degree of external and corporate authority is needed. People don't like this one either. Just me and Jesus and the Holy Spirit, that's all I need, preacher. I don't need any preacher to tell me how to study the Bible. I don't need any church and denomination to tell me. I don't need anybody. Thank goodness people didn't think like that back in the early church. What happened in the early church? When they came together, began to study the doctrine of the Trinity, or they began to study the doctrine of the Incarnation, pastors came together, church fathers came together. They said, how do we define this? We know we believe in the Trinity. We believe Jesus was fully God, fully man. How does it all work out? And they came together and they formulated the creeds. Now, sometimes I think the creeds got into too much detail, but we needed those documents. We need authority. See, the thing is, we have the pendulum has swung so far, we don't want anybody telling us what to do. Folks, that's not a good thing. Do you know that I don't just preach whatever comes to my mind? I study, I go through commentaries, I study dictionaries, theological dictionary, to make sure I'm not teaching anything wrong. Oh, that preaches good. What if I'm wrong? So once I realize, okay, so this, I can't preach that. I gotta qualify it. Authorities are there for that reason. Another one, God's word should be looked at objectively, and yet our presuppositions bring a degree of subjectivity into the process. Everybody has presuppositions, right? Everybody has certain ideas. So yes, man, I'm going to let the word speak for itself. As much as you try, you already have some presuppositions. The best thing you can do is try to get your presuppositions to line with the Bible. Am I make sense? That's the best you can do. You can never completely eradicate your presuppositions. You know, at one time people used to think that I'm just going to take everything aside, everything down, put it aside, and study the Bible for exactly what it says. Can't do it. Your presuppositions are always there. You can pray, ask the Holy Spirit to help you set aside your views, and then study the Word of God the best you can. Even I have presuppositions. The way I grew up, my experiences in life, and I struggle with that. I struggle with it constantly. So, these are the major issues that people have struggled with through the ages. We need to understand that. We need to humble ourselves and say, where do I fit in the history of biblical interpretation? Now, let's look at the history of biblical interpretation. Where does it begin? Well, major divisions in the history of interpretation. The very first people who were doing Bible study were who? The Jewish people. The Jewish people. By the way, the podcast is already out. It's there, and I know many of y'all are listening to it. It's on early Jewish biblical interpretation. I challenge you, go when you're driving, listen to it. Some things will go way over your head. Some things you'll connect with, but at least you'll be exposed to it, right? So I challenge you to listen to that. Three major divisions. Early Jewish. Second is first century interpretation. And the third one is early church and later interpretation. These are the basic bottom line divisions in how people have studied the Bible. Tonight, we're just going to focus on the early Jewish. Now, if you heard the podcast, this is a real repeat. This is for those who did not hear the podcast. When did the Jewish people start interpreting the Bible, the Old Testament? It is after the exile. Now, previous to the exile, before the exile, they would study Moses and try to figure out what he's saying and things like that. But they really became earnest after the exile. Remember the exile, the northern kingdom was taken into exile, taken away. Now, they are living in a foreign land. All this time, God promised them that through Abraham, they will have this land. They will be blessed. And then Moses came and set them free. Joshua brought them in the land of Canaan. Man, this is amazing. Grapes are this big. And you know, it's a land flowing with milk and honey. It's amazing. Well, now the Assyrians have driven them out of the land. What do we do with all the promises that God said that we are going to enjoy this land? What do we do with what God said to Abraham? How about what God said to Moses and Joshua? How does that work now? Now they had to take the same book and interpret it for their situation. That's when biblical interpretation began. Somewhere, I mean, it was always there. In fact, you read the book of Deuteronomy, that's biblical interpretation. If you read, how many of y'all ever read 1st, 2nd Chronicles? Have you been blessed by it? I mean, you will find some of the best statements in 1st, 2nd Chronicles. Remember 2nd Chronicles 7:14, if my people call by my name and all that? That's in Chronicles. It is interpreting 1st and 2nd Samuel and 1st and 2nd Kings. Yes, that's when they had to come back to the Bible and say, okay, now what? We're not in the land anymore. Now what? What do we do with all the things God said he's going to bless us? We're not even in the land anymore. So now you had to interpret it and go, well, okay, so what it really means is this. And if we do this, then maybe we'll get back in the land. Before this, it was just cut and dry. Do this and you will live. Don't do this and I will send the Philistines against you. Now it was like, well, we're not even in Israel anymore. What do we do? Now you have to interpret. Now you have to deal with the text. Does that make sense? You have to struggle with the text. And the latter prophets, they had to do that. So here's some things that they struggle with. And I got this from Gerald Bray's book, Biblical Interpretation, Past and Present. It's a great book. I won't suggest investing in it, but if you like to look at it, it's in my library. You're welcome to check it out if you want to buy it, okay? So here are some questions they were struggling with. How can an ancient text be applicable at the present time? Here's another one. What are the limits of Judaism? What does that mean? What are the limits of Judaism? Because now you have Samaritans who are calling themselves part of the Jewish people. They are claiming the same books. Well, you can't do that. Why can't we do that? Can you give us some reasons why we can't hold on to Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy? Why is it not our heritage too? Now you have to interpret it and say, these are the reasons why this is not for you. How about the Gentiles who got saved? Well, where do we fit in? Well, let's see. We got to find a way to fit you guys in. Now you have to interpret the promises of God. Right? Now interpretation comes in. Now you have to set the limits of Judaism. Who is a Jew and who is not? How can Judaism be defended against his rivals? Because guess what the rivals did? You said God is your God and he gave you the land. Guess what? You're not in the land anymore. You must not be God's people. Let's go through Moses. Let's go through David. Let's see what we can say to these people. We have to interpret the scripture and present it in a way that they understand that we are still God's chosen people. You see that in the book of Daniel, don't you? You see that in the book of Nehemiah, in Malachi. What is the place of oral tradition in relation to the written word? You know, through the centuries, I know I'm going deep tonight, just hang in there. Through the centuries, the Jewish people had passed down interpretation of the law. And guess what? This will surprise some of you. The oral tradition had more authority than the written. Why? Because the oral is fresh, the written is old. The Torah, well, we're not in the land anymore, so I mean, that's, maybe it doesn't apply to us. Oral, Rabbi so-and-so said this. Well, that must be more important. So now you have to deal with this question. We have all these books of oral and written tradition, and now we have the Torah. What do we do with these two books? With these two categories? Should we keep them both? Should we throw away one, or we throw away this one? What do we do? Which one gets more priority? These are things that are part of the biblical interpretation in the Jewish period. And here's another one, the last one. When will the Old Testament promises to Israel be fulfilled? Through you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. We're not even in the land anymore. God has forsaken us. Have you ever read the book of Ezekiel? How many of y'all read the book of Ezekiel? Promise after promise that it's not over for you, and it's not over for the Edomites, and it's not over for the Egyptians, it's not over for them, it's not over for them. What is happening is, in this book, God is, through his prophets, he is interpreting the old, and he is giving his word and saying, it's not over, it's not over, it's not over. Folks, unless you have this understanding when you just open the Bible, okay, that's what it says right there. It's like you're farming with a big metal rod, you know. Oh, I'm plowing, man. I'm going to have a big crop this year. No, you're not. You're going to have a bad back is all you're going to have. When you begin to understand these things, that's when you go, wait a minute, before I read Ezekiel, what is the purpose behind it? Now it makes sense. And that's just the beginning. I'm telling you, hermeneutics is a lot of fun. Once you understand these principles, it is so rewarding. When people say Bible study is boring, it's not. I think people make it boring. Right? So various methods of the time. Now, what are the various methods of the time? Well, you had many different people. Let me get over here. You have the Pharisees, it's in your notes. They had their way of interpreting the Bible. The Sadducees had their way, which was very literal. What do I mean by literal? If you heard the podcast, only the first five books really matter to them. So if it's not talking about the afterlife, we're not going to believe in the afterlife. You know, they had a problem with the resurrection. How many of y'all remember the song growing up in Bible school? The Sadducees are so sad to see, right? Because they don't believe in the resurrection. They didn't believe in the hierarchy of angels. So they had their own way of interpreting the Bible. The Pharisees, we can look at that in a different section right below. The Essenes and the Qumran community, by the way, Nicole and I went to the Qumran caves. They had an interpretation, a way of interpreting the Bible called the Pesher, which is only prophecy. When they studied the Bible, it was only for prophecy. These are the end times. So everything they studied was like, so what does this mean for the end? The diaspora, Jewish people, they had a lot of allegory, and we're going to come to that later on. But let's go back to the Pharisees for a moment. The Pharisaic period, somewhere before the coming of Jesus Christ, and then during the time of Jesus. You know, when you read the Gospels, Jesus is constantly clashing with the Pharisees. Did you notice that constantly? They have argument after argument. But here's the funny thing. Are y'all listening? Jesus probably agreed with the Pharisees way more than he agreed with anybody else. Because their way of studying the Bible was very close to the way Jesus did. That's why the Pharisees had so much problem with him. You sound like us. Why don't you join us? Let us support you. Let us endorse you. And Jesus is like, no, I'm not from you. You're a whitewashed tomb. They're like, man, we were going to get behind you, but you call us whitewashed tombs. How did they interpret the Bible? Okay, so let's look at this. There are two different schools, and I cover this in the podcast, the school of Shammai, the school of Hillel. Shammai was more conservative, Hillel were more liberal. By the way, don't think that those are the categories like what we use today, conservative and liberals. They're very different issues, okay? So the conservative, liberal words are used very differently. Hillel's won out means between these two groups, Hillel's, their way of interpreting the Bible left a mark on Jewish exegesis. They had seven basic rules. The first rule, it's in your notes. Kal vahomer. What applies in less important cases will apply in more important as well. I know it sounds confusing, but guess what? Jesus used it. We're going to see that in just a moment. I'll give you an illustration. Man, I asked you for a pen. You won't give me a pen, but you're going to give me your truck? If you're not going to even share your pen with me, you're not going to share your truck with me. So whatever applied in a passage in a small sense does apply in a bigger sense. You're going to see that Jesus uses that repeatedly. Gezerah Shaval means same word in different contexts means that same meaning in both. Same meaning should have said is present in both. Number three, I'm not going to pronounce that whole word. Repetition of a phrase means that ideas associated with it are applicable in all contexts. Number four, a principle can be established by relating two texts to each other. Now, that principle can be applied to other texts as well. You know, we do that all the time when we study the Bible. We take a passage, I'm trying to think of an illustration. Oh, yeah, let's take Satan. Satan sometimes comes as an angel of light, other times he comes as a roaring lion. We put those two things together and we say, man, he is very deceiving. Folks, nothing new there. 2,000 years ago, people had a technique by which they interpret the scripture. Put these two passages together, come up with a principle, now use that principle everywhere. So we take it to the book of Job, and we said Job was very deceiving. He was trying to outsmart, Satan was very deceiving. He was trying to outsmart Job, and he was trying to take advantage of him. See, what we're doing is we're taking an idea about Satan that we got from two passages, and now we're applying it over here. Most of us are doing these things already, but it's hit or miss. The Jewish people, the rabbis, the midrash, had a system by which they went. That's what we're doing tonight, giving you that system. I'm not saying the system is correct or not, okay? So there are places it's not, doesn't stand very well. Number five, in certain cases, a general principle may be restricted in its application by certain qualifications placed upon it. And conversely, particular rules may be generalized for similar reasons. How many of y'all remember when Jesus condemned them by saying, you know, you talk about paying tithe of mint and cumin, and yet in the weightier matters of the law, you are gypping people. That's what he's talking about. Man, you are so particular about these tiny little things, and yet you are scheming people in big things. When you should be showing mercy, you show judgment and hatred. You know what he's attacking? He's attacking their hermeneutics. It was not about mint or cumin. It was about how you study the Bible. That's why people, when they sometimes preach, I've heard messages on how the Pharisees would bring a little piece of mint and a little, they didn't do that. Are y'all still with me or have I lost you? They did not do that. They did not show up at the temple with a piece of little branch and say, oh, this is my tithe for this. He was using, you know, sarcasm. He said, you make a big deal out of small issues, but here when you should have showed mercy and charity and love, you can't do that. It is Jewish sarcasm. Number six, difficulty in one text may be resolved by comparing it with another passage which is similar. Verbal correspondence is not required. It means you don't have to have the same words to say, these two things are talking about the same issue. Number seven, a meaning may be established by the context, which I think you and I know is a big part of biblical interpretation. So which ones did Jesus and the apostles use? They used a lot of them, and they also used some that are not part of these principles. For example, let's begin with the first one, and I'm going to get y'all to help me finish the rest of them. You should have blank in that last column. Let's start with the first one. In Mark chapter 12, verse 18, some, who are they? Sadducees. By the way, how do they interpret the Bible? Very literally. They don't get into Midrash. That's a Pharisee business. Very literal. If it's not there, we don't believe in it. Then some Sadducees who say there is no resurrection came to him and they asked him, saying, Teacher, Moses wrote to us that if a man's brother dies and leaves his wife behind and leaves no children, his brother should take his wife and raise up offspring for his brother. Now, you know, we think, man, come on, you're trying to trip Jesus up. No, I think that was a real question. Now, there were seven brothers. The first took a wife, and dying he left no offspring. Second took her, and he died, nor did he leave any offspring. And the third likewise. So the seven had her and left no offspring. Last of all, the woman died also. Therefore, in the resurrection, when they rise, whose wife will she be? For all seven had her as a wife. Jesus answered and said to them, Are you not therefore mistaken because you do not know the scripture nor the power of God? For when they rise from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like angels in heaven. But concerning the dead, that they rise, have you not read in the book of Moses, in the burning bush passage, how God spoke to him, saying, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. So let's see. I'm going to throw it out there for you guys. How did Jesus use that technique of literal interpretation of the Sadducees to answer them? What exactly is going on? What exactly is Jesus saying to them? So y'all think through an answer. Raise your hand and I'll find you. Hey, Rachel, go ahead. Okay, go for it. We'll watch you fall. Number five. Wait, hold up. Now, keep in mind, these are Pharisees. Tell me why you think so. Let's ask you that question. Why do you think so? Go for it. Try it. You had it. It just kind of like fleeted away. Try it. Whatever you think, it comes to your mind. Keep in mind the Pharisees were listening too, so it's not like he was only talking to the Sadducees. Okay. Okay, so there is something with some midrash in it. Okay. All right. James, you want to try it? Keep in mind, Jesus is talking to the Sadducees, so the Pharisaic interpretation doesn't apply there as much. Now, Rachel, what she said is right. Because I can see number five coming through in that principle. Because Jesus is not just talking to the Sadducees. The Pharisees are there too. The disciples are there. Everybody's there. But I want you to think more for Sadducees. How did they interpret the Bible? Very literal. Very literally, right? So how did Jesus come back at them? Give you a hint between verses 25 and 26. Cindy, you want to try it? Right. Very well. Go ahead. Right. He's quoting the... Yep. He's going to the books that they... Number one. And both are, by the way, right. And so is Rachel, too. He is first and foremost going for the five books, but he's also telling them, do you really take those words literally? I am. Means, guess what? Those guys are maybe dead, but they are still coming back to life one day. He is not, I was the God of Abraham. I was the God of Isaac. I was the God of Jacob. I am. He is telling them, do you really take the word literally? How about taking that literally too? He's catching them in their own interpretation. By the way, do you know nothing more is explained here because the people got it. The Pharisees got it. And the Sadducees got it. They're like, oops, this guy knows his stuff. Did anybody else understand this or still kind of lost? Right.
I know what he's saying.
Right.
I know he's saying when they come back, they're not human and married. They're like angels.
Right.
And if God were living and not dead, when you say look at it that way, all right, it's a little man.
But if you see that verse 26, but concerning the dead that they rise, have you not read in the book of Moses? So Sadducees, Daniel won't work for them. Job will not work for them. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, right? That is where they turn. But also, he said, have you not heard what God spoke to him, saying, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, which means they are coming back to life. Take it literally. And they're like, no, we don't want to take it literally. Yes, sir. Right. Absolutely. That's right. I mean, he is being very literal with them. Absolutely. I mean, there's layers of meaning there. What if I step back? You going to follow me? Okay. There you go. You're right. He's being very literal with them. Because they're being literal, he's being literal. I mean, you can. There's some more points in there, by the way. Yes, sir. Right. Right. Yeah, and Jesus turned it around on them and said, well, how about explain this to me? Very literal. Oh, yeah. This is just one example of his interaction with the Sadducees. There is many more. And once you get this in your mind, literal, five books, man, you have a lot of fun with it. You go, oh, he's getting them here and here and here and here. Let's go to the second one. Luke chapter 4, verse 16. So he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, stood up to read, and he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. When he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." Then he closed the book, gave it back to the attendant, sat down, and the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him, and he began to say to them, what? Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. So, which interpretation is Jesus using? This is a simple one. Which one? Prophecy. Yeah, he's using prophecy. And which group was big on prophecy? Which group was big on prophecy? Huh? The Essenes? No? Let's see. Essenes, the Qumran community, they were big on prophecy. I mean, whatever you read is happening right now. Here's my question to you. When Jesus said those words, do you think in the crowd there were some Essenes sitting there? Do you think the Sadducees would get anything out of that one? Like, fulfill right now? Nah. For one, we don't put that much in the book of Isaiah anyways. You know, just by knowing these things, you can pretty much tell who is in the audience. Am I losing all of you, or are you still with me? Just by knowing some of these things, now you can tell who was sitting in his audience. And what was their response? Oh, yes, the kingdom of God has come. They'll say, no. We know who you are. By the way, Nazareth, we've been to Nazareth. Did you know it was a small community and they were mostly of a priestly class? It was an apocalyptic community. You know what apocalyptic means? Everybody knows, you know, they believe that the end time is here. So he was talking to his audience who believed in prophecy, who believed that the end time was here. Jesus said, it's here. And they said, nope. We know your father, we know your mother, we know you're illegitimate. Jesus spoke to them in their language and they still rejected him. It's the human heart, isn't it? All right, let's go to number three. John chapter 7, verse 23. Now we're looking at more of a Pharisaic interpretation. I'm sorry? You don't have a second page? There is no number three. I am so sorry. How did that happen? Can you find John chapter 7, verse 23? This is a Bible study, folks. Thank goodness it was there, not the other points. By the way, everything is on the blog, so you can cheat, by the way. I already have the answers up there. One teacher is cheating over there. John 7, 23. All right, who wants to read it for us loud and clear? All right, yes, sir.
If a man on the seventh day receives circumcision, but the law of Moses should not be broken, or be angry at me because I have made a man every way whole on the seventh day.
All right, so this is Pharisaic, because the Pharisees were questioning him about healing on the Sabbath. Which rule did Jesus throw in their face? Remember the list of seven rules? Which one did he use? Nicole? Nikki? Okay, but this is Jesus saying it. So which one do you think? Do you think Jesus was using number five? Or does it you think that's what they were saying? Okay. Right? So now, which one do you think Jesus is using? You're right about the number five, Nikki, but which one now is Jesus using? Number one. Why do you think so, number one? You know, when you understand that what's happening there is much more than what you read over the surface, that's when you realize there is a big hermeneutical battle going on between Jesus and the scribes and the Pharisees. James, you're absolutely right. Yeah. Right.
But are you upset because I healed the man on the seventh day, which also God said that his son will come and by signs and wonders? So this healing is, I'm thinking this healing should let them know this is the Messiah.
Oh, of course.
This is what God said.
Yeah.
I'm doing to verify why.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's in the grand scheme of things, that's exactly what Jesus is doing. But in the immediate context, what he's doing is he is turning their first principle of interpretation back on their head and saying, so what do you say now? They didn't like it. Yeah, that's where he's headed to. He's saying, look, I'm the Messiah. I'm the Son of God. But you're right. Interesting, isn't it? John chapter 10, verse 34. Who wants to read that one? Yes, sir. Verse 35 and 36. Which principle Come on, folks, this should be an easy one. Which one? Six? Okay. Why do you think six? He's comparing two scriptures. Okay, that can definitely be number six. Okay. Anything else? Number two? Okay. Why number two? By the way, my answers online are not wrong. I'm just giving you one that stood out to me, but that doesn't mean others are not being used there, okay? Why number two? Same words? Could be. Same word is being used. Number four? Okay, why number four? A principle can be established by relating two texts to each other. That principle can be applied to other texts. You think number four? It works, yeah. It's like nobody wants to give the right, the bad answer, wrong answer. The one that jumps out to me is number one. Because what he is doing is he's taking something less important. He said, over here, he said that to people, you are gods. To the ones who receive the word of God. And I'm here to say, I am the Son of God. Why do you have a problem with that? So if it applied in a lesser context, it should definitely apply in the higher context. Now you see there's problems in that interpretation, right? What Jesus is not saying, I go by this interpretation. He is throwing their way of studying the Bible back in their face and saying, now answer that. He's not endorsing anything. Is everybody clear on that? He is not endorsing any of this. He is simply using their technique back at them. And it really aggravated them because Jesus was not, he hadn't gone to the seminary, so to speak. It's like, how does he know these things? Right. That's right. I agree. Right. No, that's a good point. You do have a point. Anybody else want to share anything on that one? You answer. You tell me. What do you think? It is, but they weren't humbled. That's the problem. They weren't humbled. They kept arguing with him. Yes, sir.
So would this be a case where we should look at it and think and know the danger of trying to understand Scripture through the mind and not through the heart? I'm loving God with my mind and my actions.
Yep.
My heart's far from it.
That happened to them. Yep. Yep. And you're not humble enough to receive it here. You're going by this. Am I right? Am I right in taking what you're saying? That's what happened to them, didn't it? They had this whole system, this elaborate system. And they were right on about many things, but the right on pointed to Jesus. And he said, I'm the one. Oh, no, we don't want you. You're not the one. Why not? Well, because in the law and the Moses and all this stuff, that's what it says. We said, well, before Abraham was, I am. I mean, he used a lot of those techniques. Once you understand what he was doing, it's like, it is really fun to read it. It's like, wow, he's debating with them. He's not endorsing any of this. He's just debating back and forth, and they're going, man, we really don't like him now. See, now you see how it's very good. The common people who did not know all these techniques said, we like him. Because he teaches with authority, not like the scribes and the Pharisees. They're already always like wondering which one is the right one. Man, he speaks with confidence. He speaks with power. So the common people loved him. And exactly, my sheep hear my voice. And they know me. See how the scripture all of a sudden is throbbing now? Here's deadness, and all of a sudden there's life. And there are hundreds of these examples. It'll blow your mind how many. Here's another one. Peter did it too, by the way, in Acts chapter 2, verse 25, and Acts chapter 2, verse 34. Somebody read Acts 2, 25, and somebody read Acts 2, 34. Oh, you're reading Acts 2:25. Yes. Yes, sir. Okay, so what passage is Peter quoting there? Psalm what? Can you say it louder? Can we turn the lights up a little bit so people can read? 16 verse 9, is it? 8. Okay. All right. So Acts chapter 2 verse 34. What passage? Can somebody read that and tell me which one it is? Acts chapter 2 verse 34. Acts chapter 2, verse 34. Who's reading it? Okay. And what passage is he quoting there? Psalm 110. All right, so what is Peter doing? He's taking Psalm 16 and Psalm 110, putting it together. What rabbinic principle is being used there out of the seven? Four? Okay, four is what? A principle can be established by relating two texts to each other. That principle can be applied to other texts. Now keep in mind, he is not using it for another text. He's simply putting those two principles together. So there is no third text involved there, at least. Two? Why two?
Same word, different context, means the same thing. Same in the book.
Yep. You're getting it. Where did Peter learn this? From Jesus. 3.5 years of listening Jesus debate with the Pharisees, they picked up a few things. And what was Peter? A fisherman. Folks, you know what that means? When people begin to listen, and they listen, and they listen, after a while it begins to connect, and you go, I get it. I get it. And who is Peter talking to on the day of Pentecost? Who is there? All kinds of people. And he, in the midst of it, he throws in a rabbinic principle. 5,000 got saved. Hermeneutics matters. Amen? All right. By the way, this one I was debating how many from Paul should I put in. I just put one. Well, we could have been here until like 10 o'clock tonight just looking at the bunch that Paul uses. Look at Romans chapter 11, verse 12. Again, I'm using a lot of the first and second ones for time's sake, but so kind of give you a little hint there. Somebody read that for us. Romans 11:12. Go ahead. Which principle? Number one, why do you think so, Nikki? Yeah, some lesser to greater. Yeah, absolutely. And the thing is, both Jesus and Paul do this constantly. They take principles like this, but they don't endorse anything. They don't support any one principle. Sometimes they use many different principles at the same time. But this debate is going on in Scripture. Look at the last one. By the way, the book of Hebrews, again, we could be here for a whole day. It is full of these principles, full of it. And I know some of y'all are doing Hebrews on Sunday morning, Sunday school. I tell you, it'll be hard to understand this book unless you understand a little bit about Jewish exegesis. It's full of it. Full of it. You know why people get into so much trouble in the book of Hebrews with all the warning passages about you may lose the faith. How can they who have tasted walk away? Can they ever be saved again? You know, what is happening? Why are people misunderstanding the book of Hebrews? Because they ignore Jewish exegesis. Many times what is being done is like irony or hyperbole is being used. And people go, oh no. That, you know, that means you can lose your salvation. That's not what it's saying. Okay? So let's look at Hebrews chapter 1, verses 5 on. Somebody read that for us from 5 through 13. Keep going to verse 13. It's a long.
And again, we bring it in the first God to the world and say it, and let all the angels of God worship him. And as the angels he said, you make it his angel spirits and his ministers bring the fire. But unto the Son he said, thy throne, O God, is whatever it is. The scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. God.
That technique is known as pearl stringing, where many verses are put side by side to make a point. And it's not in your notes, but that's one I wanted to put in there just because Paul in the book of Hebrews are full of rabbinic exegesis, full of it. And Paul does not say one is better or this is the only one I'm going to use. Sometimes he throws the entire interpretation out, entire technique out. He does that with Abraham, that with Sarah and Hagar. Remember that? You know, the heavenly Jerusalem and the earthly Jerusalem and the mountain here and the mountain there. You're going, what in the world are you doing? The lesson tonight is not to tell you that everything goes by the rules. It's only to teach you that there are some interpretive skills that we need to understand, we need to be exposed to. So when we come to the Bible, don't just say, well, that's what it says. Stop, study. This is where commentaries come in. This is where scholarly works come in. I can guarantee you, those who are here tonight and those who are listening or watching via Facebook or Twitter or Periscope, now when you go to the scripture, you're going to stop and say, what's going on here? And if this doesn't make sense in the first reading, there is a reason. There's something happening here, something that Jesus is doing that I'm not exposed to. And once you understand that, it helps you. You struggle with it, you deal with it, and you get the meaning that comes through in the end is much fuller and much more fulfilling than what you have in the beginning. Does anybody have anything to share before we close? Yes, sir. Right.
They're taking scripture, going back at you with scripture, telling you to look back at your scripture so you won't be living in the lake of fire the rest of your life.
Right. Absolutely. You nailed it, yep. And on the road to Emmaus, what do you think Jesus did? He went through the Old Testament and he walked through it. And what was their reaction after it was all done? Then our hearts, what does it say? Burn within us. Folks, what I did tonight for you, in some sense, that's what you have to do. When you begin to read with Christ in mind, your hearts begin to burn. You go, oh my goodness, this is real. This is what it's all about. God is real. Christ is the way. And he came, and there is a destiny. We're headed somewhere. I mean, it fires you up. The reason people are so dull and dead in churches is because they don't see Jesus. It's just a book. It's more than a book, right? It's a divine book. All right, so that's our lesson tonight. And next week, we're going to go even further. And tonight, we focused on the Jewish exegesis. But next week, we're going to focus on the various models of studying the Bible. How do we come to a passage? What lens do we use? What happens there? All right, so somebody's going to get the Holman Bible Atlas. By the way, I like this one too. It's more updated than the one I have. All right, so who gets it? Me again?
All right.
And the ones who got it last week, sorry, Brad, you can't have it, okay? Oh, I dropped it. Mr. Alton, where are you at? There you go. It's for you. Come on up. Let's bow our heads in prayer. God, we thank you tonight. Thank you, God, for teaching us and exposing us to something that typically we never get to. We just begin with a pad and paper and pen, and we begin to ask questions and think we can somehow discover truth. And yet, for thousands of years, things have been put into place, and we are to study it. In the power of the Holy Spirit, we have to go and dig into the Word. And there is so much that we glean, and so much we benefit from. Tonight, I pray, God, let none of us be discouraged. Let us not be overwhelmed. But help us to walk away from this place with a renewed desire to study more. But in all of this, Lord, help us to not lose our focus. Jesus Christ, He is the Word of God. And then help us, God, to share that gospel with every man, woman, child. In Jesus' name we pray, let everyone say, amen.